in the time for meeting him, Jesus was there.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
In the time for meeting him, Jesus was there. Are you in here?
Oh, yeah.
And some of you in here, you can testify that you don't have to go to the book to realize that Jesus is there. Lord have mercy. There's some things going on in your life that you have discovered that Jesus is that. Matter of fact, I put a pin mark right here. Have you ever wondered in your life if Jesus was in fact there? Has life ever placed you, or rather pushed your back up against the wall that you really wondered if Christ was there? And since he was there, when was he going to show up?
Come, say
that. Since he was there, when was he going to deliver? Since he was there, when was he going to set me? Since you're there, Lord, when are you going to make good on your promise and free your children? Lord, have mercy. And that's when God steps in and says, I'm there. I just want to know if you know how to pray. I'm there. I just want to know if you know how to worship. I'm there. I just want to know if you know how to lift up your hand. I'm there all of the time. So this text paints a picture of evangelism. Because after all, we are hooked on Jesus. Brothers and sisters, I suspect that you know that you're conscious of the fact that if the church is going to grow, those of us who are already in the church need to stay hooked to Jesus. Because you can't point other folk to Jesus if you're not hooked up to Jesus. Look at your neighbor and say, David, do you have a hook up? Yeah, you have to be hooked up. You have to be plugged in. Huh? And watch, and the wire has to be live. Huh? See, it's one thing to be hooked up, but it's another thing to be turned on. Because I don't know if the light will come on if I've never been hooked up. And that's when I discover that I'm alive. How far we've been to say, baby, I'm alive. Because I'm hooked up to Jesus. So the text gives us either 2 points, we'll shout on three and we get the three. First thing that this text, we discover in this text, is that desperation opens the door of determination. Preach about that, I'm trying to, but I say it on the back row. I said desperation opens the door of determination. We have in the text four brothers and one sick man. You know what I'm saying? You have four men and one sick man. You have four friends and one sick friend. You have five total, but there's one sick. Lord have mercy. Huh? And so you have four brothers who love their friend enough to bring him to the place where he can get what he needs. Lord have mercy. Did y'all hear what I just said? Something like that. You have to love folk enough not to leave them by the wayside, but to reach way down, just like God did for you. Reach way down and pick them up.
Yes, sir.
So, Dr. Lamar says, grace. Paints the picture of the idea. Huh? That God does not leave me where he found me.
All right now.
Huh? So listen, you can testify that God did not leave you on Skid Row.
Yes.
Huh? God did not leave you on the corner to die.
Right.
But somebody came around the corner. Over to witness to you, to tell you about a man named Jesus. Wait a minute, Pastor, so what's my job? For you to go to the same corner that God delivered you from, pull up and tell somebody else about a man named Jesus. And so, desperation opens the door for determination. They have a man or a friend who is sick of the palsy. He's sick. We don't know his name. Don't have to. We don't know what church affiliation he has. We don't know if he's Baptist, Catholic, Pentecostal, Catholic, Church of God in Christ. None of that matters at this point. What matters is that he's sick and he's in need of not only healing, but he's in need of the healer who can deliver healing. Are you in here? Because if he was in search of anybody to heal him, the four brothers wouldn't have never brought him. They could have done it themselves. But because they knew that there was somebody in the city, healing the sick, raising the dead, somebody in the city, giving sight to blind men, making a cripple man, somebody in the city whose name is Jesus. So, somebody in our proximity, here it is, they heard. They heard. Faith cometh by and by the word of God. Huh? So watch this. This brother couldn't walk. He had to be picked up, and packed. But the brothers who packed him heard. You see, you might not have 50 cents to give me, but because you about one who can give me 50 cents, you'll point me in the right direction. All you have to do is hear. That's why it's good, brothers and sisters, for you to surround yourself around folk, if you will, who are talking about Jesus. Surround your folk around, huh? Surround yourself around good company. Folk who talking about Jesus. Folk who trying to walk like Jesus. Folk who know that without God, they would be nothing. Come on here, huh? So regardless of what's in your bank account, I still owe it all to God. All to him I owe. Sin has left the crimson stain, but Jesus washed it. White as snow. And so these brothers took their friend to the place where the Bible says Jesus was preaching. You say he said he was preaching. Read the text. He was preaching. Now watch this. There's healing through the preaching. That's why you have to come to church. Because how can they hear without a preacher? And the church is a spiritual hospital for sick folk all over the nation. You know you've been sick in your day. You know you've had some weary nights. And the only thing that wiped your tears was when you found yourself in the sanctuary of God. So, Bible says, Jesus was preaching. Can I just teach it before I preach it? I'm going to get out of here. Jesus was preaching. Huh? But when you know anything, if you know anything about the gospel message, the gospel message brings forth healing and deliverance. Because you can never hear about Jesus. And you feel the same way you felt before you heard about it. As a matter of fact, I can have some conversations, sidebars with any of you in here right now. And for those of us who have had a real experience with Jesus, when you talk about him, you'll say, excuse me, brother pastor, but I get teary-eyed. Excuse me, brother pastor, but I get emotional. And that's when you are to tell your neighbor, excuse me if I get excited. Excuse me if I get emotional. But you don't know why I know. But the lie done for me. And so these brothers were desperate. Huh? They were desperate. They had a sick friend. But they brought their sick friend to the doctor. Now we don't know if they came to Jesus because they felt as though, because in this time, you know, when you're dealing with during these times, if you will, when you have leprosy, when you have palsy, was taking that you had done something real wrong. But thank God that these brothers wasn't concerned about what wrong he had done. They just took him to the one. Oh, y'all missed that. Listen, sometimes we can wondering what other folk can do, what other folk can be, and that must be the reason why they say, come on, help me again. But the reality of life is, regardless of what they've done, regardless of their private life, they still need Jesus. And you still need Jesus. I need Jesus. You need Jesus. All of God's children need Jesus. And so, they were desperate. Perhaps their counseling suggests they were desperate. Their mannerisms suggest they were desperate. But their walk suggests that they were desperate. Because they brought him to the one who's able to take all of their problems away. And desperation opens the door of determination. Are you in here? What are you talking about, Pastor Dawson? Here it is. It's in the text. I promise you I can't make this up right here in the text. The book says that they tried to go.